something triggers inside of them. But that trigger is the trauma. The trauma that lives inside of us, it lives inside our body. We think it lives inside our mind. It lives inside our body, and it is longing to be released. And I think it is the cause of all of human suffering, especially today in the last few years, what we've been through in this pandemic. So it is a complete honor to moderate this mental health panel today. I have to say, we all met on Zoom about a month ago to discuss a specific topic that was aligned with each one of us and our specific work and mission in the world. And trauma was the thread that united us all, and finding freedom from that. So it's really an honor to be here today. All right, today we are going to discuss four pivotal questions when we think about how do we find freedom from trauma. First off, what is trauma? How do we find freedom from trauma? How do we find truth? What are the tools we can use to walk through the fire? And lastly, we're all podcasters. What is our purpose? What is our mission, our intention to normalize mental health? And how does this apply to podcasting? How can we be an advocate and an ally? I'll kick it off with a little introduction and then turn it over to the panel. My name is Jessica Schiller Silverman. I am a trauma-informed wellness expert and host of the Alive podcast. It is called Alive for a Reason. I only know aliveness because I also felt dead inside for many years of my life, at times contemplating suicide. So the word alive to me is an energy in itself. I started my podcast in 2020 out of my own dark night of the soul moment, many dark nights of the soul, but really felt called to use my voice to elevate the taboo, the conversations that are not being had, so we know that we are not alone. Over to Colleen of the
Evolve
Therapist.
Hi everyone, I'm Colleen Nelson. I'm a licensed professional counselor and trauma expert. My title is the Evolve Therapist. I'm here to bring people into therapeutic healing in different and evolved ways. Traditional therapy works for many, but not for everyone. So it is my mission to use my title, my credentials, and my experience to help people heal, but in a way that fits and uses different modalities for them. My podcast is about the rest of her.
Love it. All right, next is Brent of Nightmare Success.
Hi, I'm Brent Cassity. I'm the author of the book Nightmare Success, the host of the podcast Nightmare Success In and Out. My podcast is about what happens when your worst fear becomes reality. How do you adapt? How do you survive? I know a little bit about that. I had a national company and thought I had it all. And lost it all, found myself standing at the gates of Leavenworth Prison. So everybody builds up prisons in their own mind. And that's, you know, whatever trauma that is how do you get through it. And not your success is you got to walk through your fears to get to where you want to be. And how do you set yourself free? And these are people I need.
Thank you very much, Brent. Now we have Lauren of 52 Weeks of Hope.
I am Lauren Abrams, and I can look put together, but I'm somebody that used to live in an abandoned house, and you know, I was hopeless and wanted to die, and was able to build myself out of that over many years, and always grateful. Couldn't believe I had survived and didn't want to back when I was in that situation. And then I went through my dark night of the soul and was shocked because I was always so grateful for the life I had built up. And through that, I started going interviewing people, like, why are we here? And through that, my podcast came about where I interview people about what's the hardest challenge you've gone through, how to get through it, and what you must have to hope. And we are a resilient species, and half the planet is distributing. And it's just an incredible experience, and I love podcasting.
Hey. I'm sorry, you guys, I lost my voice last night. Hi, guys, my name is Paula. I'm the host of Talk Show with Me. I like to shit, clearly. I'm a mental health advocate. I battle with depression, and I started my podcast in 2020 when depression really hit. it hard for me, and I debated ending my life. Thank God I love my dad, y'all. But and with that, I wanted to create a safe space for people to talk their shit while creating awareness to mental health. And every day I get to listen to people and share my story and encourage people that there's a way through anything. As long as you own your story, you can get out of it, you can get help, you can connect with the right people who can help you. And that just brings me joy. So I want to keep on creating that message of mental health and letting people know that they're not alone. Because that's important. Nobody wants to feel alone, right?
So important. Thank you, Paula. And I know Paula actually since I joined the podcast community. If there's anyone that's more real and more authentic, you look at her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that definition is a little bit of my own little flavor. I'll say that trauma is your body's response to a perceived threat to your survival. So I view trauma as a body response, a response that, in particular, can be ingrained from ages 0 to 10, in particular, ages 0 to 5, mainly. Right. So our body is trying to survive in the world, figure out what's going to keep us alive, what's not going to keep us alive. There's different experiences that we learn as children to figure out how that is. We are primates, so a sense of belonging is crucial to our survival. So anything that threatens our sense of belonging or a sense of self-expression is going to initiate that response in our nervous system. Trauma is stored in the back part of your brain, in the hindbrain, in your nervous system. So that's why mindset or belief systems, as much as they're extremely powerful, if you don't actually utilize the shifting of your nervous system, you're going to kind of hit back a lot with your body, right? You can think all of the things, but you can't necessarily feel them. And so trauma is stored in our body for our protection. So in order to recalibrate and shift our nervous system, we have to prove to our nervous system that what we're doing, our new belief system, our new modality, our new thoughts, are actually safe for our survival. And that can take time, healing. Breathwork is a fabulous way to do that. EMDR is a closer button. So there's lots of different ways that you can come from.
Thank you, Colleen. That was beautiful. Yeah, all roads lead back to really feeling safe is what it's all about. And probably be able to hear the science of feeling safe. Brent, what's wrong with you?
Well, I think, you know, trauma, obviously Colleen said it really well, but I think for me, trauma is that the unknown. And you, and those are all things and experiences you experience through your life, that you, when you get to that point where you know you have to take a step into the unknown, that's traumatic. You know, I go back to when I was just scared to death standing at the gates of Leavenworth. Everything I loved was behind me. Everything I knew was behind me. Everything in front of me, I didn't know if I was going to die. And taking those steps and then finding out I wasn't only not going to die, people were going to help me. And I think that when you take steps, step at a time, you gain a little bit of confidence, and the trauma takes a back step. You know, I always say the trauma, everybody has it. Just don't let it ride in the front seat with you and change the stations on the radio. It can ride in the back seat. Just don't let it have control. Because everybody has it, it's where you put it. And it's always there, but if you step and gain confidence, you can put it behind you.
Nice.
So let me ask this, how many bedroom cat lovers? Oh God, I'm not visiting y'all. So my biggest trauma came about when, how many of you have been to Africa? Alright, anybody has been to Tanzania, because I don't want to put the whole Africa in it, but Tanzania cats are different, okay? And I've been in different countries. Also, Malaysian cats are different, but Tanzanian cats are very spicy. They are evil. So my first trauma was with a Tanzanian cat who gave my favorite grandfather a heart attack and ended up dying. So that traumatized me until today, to the fact that even on dating apps, if I see a guy I really like but he has a cat, I'm like, no, I do not like cats. And then as I was asking people what is trauma to you after we had our Zoom, and everybody who I came across asking that question ended up finding something big. And I was like, you know, it doesn't have to be huge for it to be trauma. Any little thing, if you ever woken up off your bed and hit the pinky finger on the bed or bumped it into someone, and that shit hurts, literally. That's traumatic. Like, for a person who likes wearing heels, I can't wear heels for almost a month or sometimes 2 weeks. That's trauma for me. So anything can be trauma. But when I started talking about that and telling people about the cat story and why I don't like cats, and they're like, well, since you're talking about owning your truth and being authentic and dealing with your healing, how the fuck are you not dealing with your cat trauma? So I gotta own my shit, right? So I'm learning how to love cats. I'm not there. Slowly, but I'm not there. So all they say over here is trauma can be anything as long as it affected your mind, it's affecting your progress, it's holding you back. I have fear of public speaking. It took me a while to get me on this stage. That was a trauma to me. I almost didn't come here today. But I'm here. I'm fighting through my trauma. So anything can be trauma, but as Brent said, leave to the back seat. Don't let it control the station. Don't let it in the front seat. So, Johnny, hopefully the next time I meet, I come visit you, I'll be able to pet your cat.
I
just
want to add one thing. So that leads right in. It's a good segue into imposter syndrome. Because imposter syndrome is fear. And I've just, anyway, standing on the podcast, I'm sure when you started, like, that part of it, that whenever you start something new, it's who am I, who do I think I am? Starting a podcast for me, and on all the Zooms, I'm also a lawyer in my other life, and people would be on Zooms, and I think I'd see all the little squares, and I think everybody's talking about me, they think, who's Laura, think she is starting a podcast, and all of this, like, when did I come back till summer, that I think everybody is talking about me, they found me out, now they know, and all of this, and I got consumed with that, but I kept going anyway, like Brent said, and you just keep walking through, and I talk about it, like everyone's, and I would tell people, oh my God, I'm thinking everybody's talking about me, and talking about it, and telling other people, I'm becoming self-centered, and then it just dissipates. Talking about all of these things, and it just went away. So, and feeling the feelings, and getting, once feeling it and walking through, then you get new neural pathways, and that is how you walk through and break through the trauma.
Thank you very much, that's beautiful. So how do we find freedom from trauma, Colleen?
I think everybody has a different path. Let's say that out loud, right? Everybody has a different path to find freedom, depending on where it comes from. How I lead others through trauma, how I've led myself, is through collective, immersive experiences and through starting with the nervous system, right? So EMDR is one of my favorite modalities because it's highly effective and efficient, but it's not a standalone. I think those of us in the room, just everyone, who have experienced a traumatic experience, you feel alone. You feel like you're the only one that's experienced it, or the only one that can't get over it, or the only one that feels that certain way. So it's extremely important that we heal in communities, and we heal in ways that make us feel empowered, that make us feel hope and freedom, and that we recognize that this is an ongoing, lifelong process where we get to be with ourselves and walk with ourselves through this, and that as long as we don't forget our bodies are wise, they're trying to lead us to healing, and we lean into community, I think we can find freedom in whatever modality is works for you.
Thank you, Colleen. And we're all podcasters, right? Our throat chakra is the best way to find freedom from trauma, right? To use our voice, to use that, right, our soma, our body, to release what lives inside of us. What about you, Brent?
Well, it's really tough on my comment because she sounds like
No, we should just read the state
But I do think that, you know, so much of it's true, though, that trauma is something you don't want to just be walking in alone. And I think that's one of the things that is great about podcasting, which I know that that's one of the ending parts of what we have, so I'm hopefully not getting too far ahead of us. But being able to share and people finding that they are not the only ones walking down this weird path is something that really gets people believing that they can get through it. And I think, you know, how do you find freedom from trauma? You have to believe that you can get through it. You know, getting stuck is the trauma. The freedom is believing that you don't have to be stuck. And I think that being able to share, being able to see other people have it, people have survived it, and people are now thriving, is what frees you from trauma. And I think that's what we can do when we have a voice out there that shares other stories through podcasting.
It's as simple as only a story. I remember when the first time I literally understood what depression was and that I was getting depressed, and I felt so much shame, and especially coming from Tanzania, in Africa, people don't recognize me to have nobody who's part. Everybody tells you, that's just life. Get over it. You're going to be fine. People have harder than you. At least you have a roof over your head. I get it. I'm grateful. But I'm still going through the shit, you know? So I realized that the more I kept it inside of me, I was traumatizing myself more. And one day I just woke up and I went on Instagram and I went live and I just started sharing my depression. And we ended up creating a WhatsApp group and being supportive. And now those people are thriving, and some people still reach out to me and be like, thank you for having that group. That support is what I needed. Because sometimes you don't want to hear advice. You just want to vent. You just want to talk to somebody. You don't want somebody to tell you it's going to be fine. Get over it. You're allowed to feel what you want to feel. But also for you to be able to do that, you need to have a safe space to talk about it, right? So I feel like finding your freedom through drama is creating a space for everybody to be able to share that, without feeling judged, without feeling ashamed. And that's why my professor, she would be, I wanted to create that. And funny enough, I have 130 episodes, and my first episode, which I recorded. Recording was the easiest part. It empowered me that because I was so honest about my struggles during COVID. And until today, I've never listened to that episode. But everybody, it still gets a lot of downloads. It's one of my most listened to. And people come to me and they're like, that is so powerful. I'm like, I wanted my podcast to be the safest place, and I needed to be open so so that people who come in my space can be like, I can feel safe here. So it's just owning your story. And the more you own it, the more freedom you can get out of it. Because you connect with people who are in the same space with you. You get the support you need.
Because it's so true. I just nonchalantly said, I used to live in an abandoned house. That was my secret. I was like, what about lawyers? Now that, like, in my first episode, like, oh, you have to, and I was like, I can't tell my story. I'm interviewing people. So I did a little 15-minute bluffing thing. I knew it was nothing. And I was like, all right. And I just went, blah. And I thought, I could get hit by a bus tomorrow. That's the only reason that I could tell my real story in my first episode. I was free, and now, yes, I'm ready, I'll tell anything, I don't care, nobody's listening, nobody cares, nobody's listening, and I have to find a diplomatic word to say nobody cares, but there's freedom in it, and if it helps somebody else, great, nobody is paying that much attention to you, you know, that's the bottom line, nobody has ever come back about, really, you come back, first of all, so long ago, so really, owning your story gives so much freedom, and that is the fire, get freedom, and all of it.
Story is very powerful. And going back to what Paula said before, right? Sharing your story, being vulnerable, knowing you're not alone, but also the three most powerful words I ever say you can ever ask someone, I know they always hit my heart, is, are you okay? So simple, but so powerful. So what tools do you use, Colleen, to walk through the fire? Who are your clients?
I got drunk. honestly, so I am a certified number. And I do EMDR, but the number one thing I use to walk through the fire is actually creating space to be in it, to be in the fire, right? Like, to not distract myself, to not move through it rapidly, to not try and opt out of it, but to let it burn me to the ground. Because if we avoid that process, if we avoid the moment of clarity that comes from the catharsis and transformation of the fire, we're not actually changing, right? We're kind of doing the same pattern in a circle, which I am the queen of. Big fan of the thing I like to throw myself in the fire over and over. So I think that you have to legitimately let yourself feel it, experience it, witness it, be in it.
Can I agree more?
Yeah. No, 5 minutes.
Oh, 5 minutes, okay. But yeah, to add to your point, Colleen, suppression of emotions, suppression is a form of trauma, right? Because that allows it to further go from our heart center to live inside of our body, right? And so how do you release? What are the tools you use to walk through fire?
Okay. Jessica, this is something I've used it. It's almost like a hack. So when I go to sleep at night, and it was Leavenworth, my daughter made a calendar for me every year. And so in that calendar, I would write, you know, how did I win the day? And you think, God, how crazy is that to win the day in prison? But there had to be something that happened for me that day that I could hold on to. That, you know, I'm still me. But as I wrote in that little box, I would never, if I had a bad day, I'd let myself go all the way down. Just like Colleen said, just crash and burn and feel it. But I would never let two boxes be bad because I knew it was a slippery slope. I knew that if I had two boxes of bad, that could turn into a week, it could turn into a month, it could turn into a year. And so, and it's like Jack Nicklaus says, you hit a bad shot at golf, just don't hit two in a row, it really messes up the hole. So the idea of that you always have to be up, or you can't be up, go ahead and be both, but don't stay there. And I, you know, I always say that it's important not to be unrealistic when you're trying to live your life, is that not everybody on Instagram is living their best life. Those are pictures. And you've got to understand that everybody has their own stuff they're going through. But if you have a good day, get it, win it. If you have a bad day, own it, do it, but come back up and find another one the next day.
Absolutely, you have to feel it to heal it. And since we're a little short on time, let's get to the last question, which is the most powerful. How does this apply to podcasting and normalizing mental health?
space in my podcast to come and share your shit. You tell me that shit to share, you have a space in my podcast. Bring your shit, let's hear your shit, let's talk your shit. Because that's what I do. I want to hear your story. And I've realized that since I started podcasting, people reach out to me who I don't even know and come and tell me how much that particular episode helped them heal, helped them feel not alone. And I'm like, I want to keep doing that. And I believe that the people who come on my show will do that to somebody else. So that's how I normalize mental health in my podcast.
I get to hear from people about the hardest challenges they've gone through, how they got through it, and they give them a message of hope. And it definitely, everybody's gone through it. I mean, nobody gets through this life out of state. And if they haven't been following along, you know, I'm not going to podcast. And I just get a sense, you know, what I learned is when you start going after something you really want to do, like podcasting, people are like, how do you get these?
And so I think it's in every single episode, I'm really trying to make sure that everybody hears a struggle, hears a moment that will allow vulnerability to meet, and we let the storytelling from that place kind of emerge. And I think that's what podcasting is all about, right? Is really allowing that for each and every person's room that you're in, how the podcast has that normalized feeling just by listening or speaking into mind. So
and with that? Yeah. I got Scott to start playing the music over there. So I just want to say that the great thing about podcasts, the reason I'm in love with it is because the ideas that people share and strategies that they've gone through, their own trauma, their own stories, people listen to that and think, oh my gosh, I can make it. I can do this stuff. This could be me.
Oh, yeah, I'm not done. You want me to say something now?
No.
Hosting a discussion is just the first step, right? This was only 30 minutes, right? But ensuring that people feel really seen, heard, valued, right? These are all things that we do on our podcast that I think is really the key. I did want to end with this quote from Peter Levine. I think this is a really, really powerful quote, the founder of Somatic Experiment Theory and Somatic Movement, which is another great tool for walking through the fire. Trauma is not what happens to us, but what we hold inside in the absence of an empathetic witness. We are the empathetic witnesses as podcasters, as friends, as allies, as humans. And that is the end of our discussion today. Thank you so much for listening. Please connect with us on the Google app or scan the QR code on this last slide.
One last thing, everybody. You see my cute face? I want to be in your fridges, in your homes. I have nice feed. Manchester, come see me and get one.